there's no way to make this a simple story. So let's start at the beginning. Resistance to serial rust. And let's go to the source. Sydney University is the centre for all things rust in Australia. And Professor Robert Park is the GRDC Chair of Serial Rust Research. Put simply, some wheat varieties have resistance, some don't.
You can see by looking at the responses of each of these varieties to stem rust that some are resistant and some are not. So for example, the first one in this particular variety is completely immune to stem rust, whereas the third one here is completely susceptible. And that's shown by these large pustules. The rust is actually infected and the plant has not been able to stop that infection.
Used to be that was pretty much all there was to it, but not anymore.
In the case of this variety here, the third one, which is fully susceptible, we know from previous experience when we've grown this in the field that it actually has a level of adult plant resistance. So we're not seeing that resistance here. The plants are completely susceptible in the seedling growth stages, but the resistance switches on as the plants get older. And the plant at adult plant growth stages, as I said, is resistant.
Okay, so a wheat crop with that kind of resistance gene might need protection early on, but later in the season it would be able to do the job itself. Not too complicated so far. Of course, if you had a paddock full of it, you'd want to know when the adult plant resistance might kick in.
Depends on the actual gene we're talking about, but typically, as a rule of thumb, this occurs around tillering to node formation in the plant growth cycle.
So, you'd reckon the ideal way to manage a crop like that would be to protect it when it's young, with seed dressings and maybe with in-furrow fungicides, monitor it, and be ready to apply a fungicide spray if needed in the early stages. But after that, you can sit back and watch the plant protect itself. Well, that might be ideal, but there's an argument for spraying even after adult plant resistance has switched on. Nick Poole from Far Australia is doing research for GRDC to test that argument.
Some growers and advisors will tend to turn their back on adult plant resistance by saying, well, my crop still loses green leaf area.
That loss of green leaf area is known commonly as flecking. To a biologist, it's necrosis. It's a sign that resistance is working. When a rust spore lands, it penetrates into the tissue. A resistant plant has a mechanism that recognises the intrusion. It deals with it by killing off tissue around the site of the infection, the necrosis. It deprives the pathogen of a host and stops it in its tracks. But of course that tissue is brown, it's dead, and dead tissue doesn't photosynthesize. So despite the fact that the plant has effectively resisted the pathogen, it's lost photosynthetic area. Now you'd have to think that that would make the plant less productive, which is what the argument for spraying says. It might be right, but it would be better to have real answers.
I think it's recognised that we don't have enough hard and fast data on how much that plant reaction costs you or doesn't cost you in terms of yield.
Far Australia's integrated fungicide management project here on this Sydney Uni farm should put some real numbers on those questions.
What we're doing is looking at key fungicide timings from early through to late. And by late, we're talking at that ear emergent stage and early at just at the start of stem elongation, what we call the first node or growth stage 31. And right in the middle, flag leaf itself. If we think of the cereal plant, it's the top three leaves that we refer to sometimes on occasions as the money leaves, Daryl. They're the probably some of the most important solar panels that the plant has to keep free of disease. In a way, part of the conundrum that this trial is investigating is that if we spray early at growth stage 31, the two top leaves aren't emerged at that stage. And although that may be the best time to coincide with adult plant resistance perhaps being more active later, in putting the fungicide on then, we're not putting fungicide on those top two leaves. One of the things that we don't feel we should need to do with cultivars that have got a level of adult plant resistance, these more intermediate rated cultivars, is they shouldn't need as much support right at the end of the season, so around that ear emergence phase. But we're not quite sure whether we should be treating them there at growth stage 31, 32, or here at, as the flag leaf starts to emerge.
But just to add complication, it turns out that varieties with adult plant resistance lose differing amounts of green area when they deal with the pathogen.
Within this trial, we have two moderately resistant / moderately susceptible cultivars. One shows far more reaction and loss of green leaf than the other one does. So one becomes a much more clearer candidate for saying, well, is there any way in which we could control that reaction? And is that reaction actually significant in itself? So I think there are differences in terms of the way, how much leaf you lose before the disease is closed down.
We're making steady progress in understanding how those different varieties perform in terms of adult plant resistance. What are the key environmental factors that will actually cause that resistance to trigger and become effective? And through that knowledge, growers actually being able to make much more strategic decisions about when to apply fungicides.
With that progress, though, comes a warning. The pathogens don't stay still or stay the same. Widespread planting of susceptible varieties and unnecessary spraying are creating the conditions for the fungi to gain the upper hand.
More than 25% of the varieties grown in southern region are actually susceptible, and that's created some real challenges as the inoculum is very high of stripe rust, and as a consequence of that we've seen a lot of green bridge and consequential mutation of pathotypes. And what we're seeing now is a rapid development of new pathotypes which are knocking out the resistance genes we have for a number of varieties.
We see in situations where the rates of vaccination against, say, whooping cough have dropped, whooping cough has made a comeback. And rust is very, very similar. So if the industry is to be protected as a whole from rust, with genetics, we really need adoption across the entire industry of rust resistance.
I think first and foremost, we have to remember we're about trying to control the disease. We're trying to break the disease cycle. And the green leaf retention argument is something that we're trying to put some figures around. But ultimately, I think growers need to think in terms of how they can reduce the levels of inoculum in their crop